You're listening to the audio production of Message of the Prophets, a survey of the prophetic and apocalyptic books of the Old Testament by J. Daniel Hayes. This lecture by the author was recorded before a live audience and is based on his book by the same title, published by Zondervan.
Well, welcome to this study of the Old Testament prophets. Of all the classes that I teach, I think the prophets is my most favorite class. And I hope that as we study this together and as you work through the material with me, that you also come to appreciate the prophets, that you also are moved by them, inspired by them, that you also are drawn closer to God through your study with the prophets, and that by the end of the study, that like me, you're saying, wow, that's one of my most favorite parts of the Bible. Part one, we're going to deal with the big picture, and we're going to give some background on our study of the prophets. So in the first five chapters, for example, we're going to talk about in chapter one, the history of prophecy within Israel. What do we actually mean by the term prophet? What about prophecy in the ancient Near East? And then in chapter two, we're going to deal with the prophets in history. What's the geopolitical background? Chapter three, we'll deal with the nature of the literature and the challenge of the actual literature, interpreting the literature of the prophets. Chapter four, we're going to focus on the summary, the message, what's the core message that the prophets convey to us. And then in chapter 5, we'll be dealing with the prophets in eschatology. Where do they fit with biblical eschatology today? Okay, so chapter 1, the prophets and prophecy. We want to talk about what's the nature of the prophets and what's the history of the prophecy within the Old Testament. The Apostle Peter underscores the nature of the Old Testament prophetic books when he writes, "No prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation, for prophecy never had its origin in the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit." In the prophets, you see God unfolding his redemptive plan. It's going to carry over from the Old Testament message into the New Testament. It is the bridge. And then Jesus himself so interconnects his message and his imagery, the images that he uses, to that of the Old Testament prophets, that they're inextricably linked together. And keep in mind, the prophetic books take up as much space as the entire New Testament does. So obviously, this is a very important part of the biblical text that we need to study. The prophets are very unique, and they're fascinating to study, and there's the elements in them that are very different than other parts of the Bible. They are very harsh in their critique, you know, of sin and of injustice. But then the prophets are going to teach us about God. He shows up a lot in the prophetic text. He speaks in first person repeatedly through the prophets, so we hear his word directly. The prophets teach us about people and our characteristics and faithfulness and love and loyalty, and then they ultimately point us towards the Messiah. And the prophets will have a strong prophetic aspect pointing to the Messiah and the coming of Jesus Christ that's important for us to understand. So the prophetic books of the Old Testament, they're grouped into two major groups, what we call the major prophets, the four major prophets being Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. And then there's 12 minor prophets: Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. And the order between major and minor doesn't reflect importance. It just reflects size. What we call the major prophets are the bigger ones, and the minor prophets are simply the smaller ones. In the Hebrew Bible, which is called the Tanakh, it's organized a little bit differently. The first part, the Pentateuch, which they call the Torah, is similar to ours. But then the prophets come next, and in Hebrew they're called the Nevi'im. And when they say prophets in the Hebrew Bible, there's two parts of this. There's the former prophets, which is Joshua, Judges, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings. They're called prophets probably because they were written by prophets. And then you have the latter prophets, which are the ones that we know as the literary prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and so on. And so that's the Nevi'im. And then the writings, the Ketuvim, is the final part. This is Psalms and the wisdom literature and some other books, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ruth, and Esther. Those three, the acronym Tanakh is formed by those three, the Torah, the Nevi'im, and the Ketuvim. Those three letters are combined together to form Tanakh, and that's what the Jews call the Hebrew Bible today. Now, in the Hebrew Bible, Daniel's not included with the prophets, but he's included with the writing. So in the Hebrew Bible, Daniel's there with Psalms, Ecclesiastes, Ruth, etc., than with the prophets that seem to be put there because of the wisdom components of the book. But in Christian Bibles, we have Daniel listed with our major prophets, you know, right after Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and then Daniel, because of the prophetic element that you see in the book of Daniel. Well, let's talk about the history of prophecy within the Old Testament. How did it develop, and what was the office of the prophet all about? And the role of the prophet in the Old Testament is closely associated with delivering the Word of God. The prophet is the one who actually delivered the Word of God. And we see this in Exodus 7:1. God tells Moses that Moses will be like God to Pharaoh and that Aaron would be his prophet. And this implies that Aaron's role would be to speak the word of God to Pharaoh. In fact, in Deuteronomy, Moses is identified as the prophet primarily because of his important role in delivering the word of God. Like most of the book of Deuteronomy, he delivers directly. It is the word of God to the people. That is a prophetic role. In Deuteronomy 18 presents guidelines for the people concerning prophets and prophecy. As they go into the promised land, here's how you can recognize true prophets and here's how you recognize false prophets. And in that text, God promises to raise up another prophet like Moses, one whom the people should listen to and obey. And on the other hand, within that text, God strictly commands them to watch out for false prophets and not to listen to the false prophets. So in the historical books, especially 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, several prophets are going to play key roles in the biblical story. You're going to see Samuel, then Nathan, Elijah, and Elisha. These are all prophets, and we see them in the historical books before the literary prophets began to appear in the story. So the role of the prophet takes on a special significance in times, especially when the Israelite monarchy and the Israelite priesthood turn away from God. And here's what happened. As the monarchs turn away from God in the story of Israel, what they try to do is subdue the other important offices. You kind of have a power triad in Jerusalem. You have the monarchy, the king, you have the priesthood running the temple, and then you have the prophets off to the side. And what happens as the kings turn away from God, they want to subdue or dominate the other two classes, and they're very effective at subduing the priesthood, and the priesthood becomes a tool of the royal court. The prophets, on the other hand, are harder to control, and the prophets become God's voice to the king, especially when the king leads his people away from God. So you're going to see the prophets at odds with the kings and with the royal court, and that seems to be an important part of their role. The prophets Elijah and Elisha are going to dominate the end of 1 Kings and the beginning of 2 Kings, and they predate the literary prophets by about 100 years. But they set the pattern that the literary prophets are going to follow. They have a constant confrontation with the king because the king has turned away from God. They're going to have a call to repentance to the king. They're going to call the king and his people and his court and his leaders to faithful obedience to Yahweh, and then they're going to warn of imminent judgment if these heedings go if his warnings go unheeded. So now let's discuss the terminology. What are the terms that are used when the Old Testament speaks of prophets? They have really three words that they use for those who prophesy. One of them is just the Hebrew word prophet. The Hebrew is Navi, and it gets just translated as prophet. Another term is seer, and this means, you know, the one who sees, the one who can see visions or see the future and can see these things. So this word seer is another term that's used. The third term is just man of God, and this term is going to also be used of prophets, especially in the historical books. These three terms appear to be, you know, nearly synonymous. In 1 Samuel 9, they use all three terms, and you can see there's a certain synonymous aspect to them. However, the term man of God is not used in any of the literary prophets, like Isaiah and Jeremiah, but it's used only of those prophets in the historical books. And the term seer was apparently an older designation for a prophet, perhaps more prevalent in the early history of Israel. Note that in 1 Samuel 9:9, the text says the prophet of today used to be called a seer. So they're explaining to newer audiences that this term has changed. So seer might have been used in some of the earlier history of Israel. The term seer is also used primarily in the books of 1 and 2 Chronicles, where in addition to Samuel, it's used of several other people. The term man of God is used interchangeably with the term prophet throughout the books of 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings. The prophet Elijah is called the man of God numerous times throughout his career. In fact, man of God is the primary term that's used for Elisha in the books of 1 Kings and 2 Kings. Elijah, however, it's very interesting, is not called the man of God until one of the very last episodes at the end of his life in 2 Kings 1. And I think one of the reasons for this is there's a fun word play taking place in this episode. The Hebrew word for man is ish, but the Hebrew word for fire is ash. The words are very similar and very close, and there's a word play that takes place here. Elijah's up on top of this hill. The king sends a group of soldiers to capture him. The captain of the guard calls up to Elijah and says, "Man of God, Ish Elohim, man of God," the king says, "come down." And Elijah answers, "If I am a man, Ish of God, then Ish will be what comes down. So if I'm an Ish of God, then God's going to send Ish, fire." And sure enough, fire comes down and consumes those hostile soldiers. In general, the term man of God is associated with one who delivers the word of the Lord. Thus, it's applied a few times to Moses. It's applied to David. But unlike the term prophet, man of God is only used in the Bible of true prophets. There aren't any false men of God that are used in the Bible. So prophets can be used for false prophets, true prophets. Man of God only seems to be used for true prophets. Within the prophetic literature, the major term used for prophets is the term Navi, which is generally just translated as prophet. But this term is used both of true prophets and of the false prophets. Prophecy in the ancient Near East. Many of the nations and religions of the ancient Near East that surrounded Israel during this Old Testament era also had prophets and other prophet-like individuals who reportedly functioned as intermediaries between the pagan gods and their respective monarchies. They usually reported to the king. And we see this repeatedly in the Bible. 1 Kings 18, the prophet Elijah confronts 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of Asherah. And in 27:9, Jeremiah proclaims to the surrounding nations. He says, "So do not listen to your prophets." He's addressing the monarchs of the nearby kingdoms of Moab and Edom and Ammon. They're plotting a rebellion. He says, "Do not listen to your prophets, your diviners, your interpreters of dreams, your mediums or your sorcerers who will tell you, you will not serve the king of Babylon." So, and this indicates that the royal courts of the surrounding countries had official court prophets and other prophet-like classes of people. And in this case, they were contradicting what Jeremiah was proclaiming. Also, from non-biblical literature, from the Assyrians and Babylonian archaeological sites in Mesopotamia, thousands of clay tablets have been recovered. Many of these tablets mention the court prophets who functioned in the Assyrian and Babylonian courts, although a wide range of terminology is used for these individuals and their occupations. And it's often difficult to translate exactly what these terms mean. But in Mesopotamia, those involved in bringing oracles and other messages from the gods are given official titles. And so these titles are like answerer, the one who answers, or the cult functionary. And again, translations are difficult. There's the title of the ecstatic, the diviner. And this word is very similar to the Hebrew Navi or prophet. There's the proclaimer or the revealer. And this word is very similar to the Hebrew term for seer. And then there's the sent one. And these prophets in these royal courts throughout Mesopotamia appear to have a fairly high status in the royal court of the ancient Near East. So they were very much respected and revered. But many of the specific practices, such as sorcery and necromancy, that means to those who bring back the dead, to talk to the dead, many of the things that they were doing to try and tell the future or give advice to the king, many of these practices for these prophet-like people in the Old Testament world, these were explicitly prohibited for Israel back in Deuteronomy 18, 9-22. So throughout the time of the Israelite and the Judahite kings, often the backsliding Hebrew kings. They would try to copy the pattern of the royal courts in the countries around them, and so they would also include prophets, not prophets of Yahweh, but prophets of these other gods, and they would often employ some of these practices that were used around them that were strictly prohibited in the book of Deuteronomy. False prophecy. False prophets and their false prophecies are fairly common.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.